Morning, church. How are we feeling? Good? Okay, let's all stand. Let's get ready to worship our God together. Let's do it.
Now Everybody, good morning, good morning. Have a seat. I hate to interrupt that energy. That was great singing, wasn't it? Are you grateful this morning for God's amazing love? How about God's amazing grace? You're grateful for that too? Give him an amen. I am so thankful too, because he's a God of not one chances, two chances, but a million chances, right? He'll always take us back, and I'm grateful for that. Well, welcome to Crossroads Church Village Bible Church. We're glad that you're here today. If you are new, we'd like to connect with you. We have a connect desk out in the atrium, so you can stop by there. Take Five. Oh, yeah, it's called Take Five now. I forgot. I can't keep up with these name changes. Or if you don't want to stop by there, there is a, it still says connect card. How about that? Take a connect card, fill that out, put it in the offering box in the back. But we would like to connect with you, and we're really glad that you're here today. In 2 weeks, October 10th, what time? 10 a.m., if you show up here, there's going to be anybody here. Head on over to Gary Avenue. We're having a special service outside in a tent. Yep. In the round, Ike?
It's going to be great.
It's going to be so good.
Uh-oh, here he comes.
That it's everyone, and here's the thing. We're going to have 1,000 people there. That's what I'm hoping for. But more importantly is after the 10 at 10 a.m., we're going to have lunch.
Yep.
And for everyone, all these people right over here,
beside?
Carnival. Woo! Afterwards on the lawn, okay? And I think Brother Isaiah is also going to be doing a concert with the Rotunda. It's a full day of fun. So be there.
Rotunda.
It's going to be awesome.
Yeah.
Thank you. The mic. We're going to do our offering now. You see the guys coming up? Oh, we don't do that anymore. There is a black box in the back. You can give online. Please give. We have to pay for guys like this. Somehow, some way, we got to pay for this. But that's going to be a great day. Why don't we pray for our offering and pray for our service? Dear Lord, thank you that we can be here today. Lord, we're grateful for your amazing love, your amazing grace that you just keep giving us over and over. We want to thank you for that. Lord, we thank you for blessing us monetarily, all that you've given to us, and we want to give back to you cheerfully with our hands wide open because you've been so generous with us. Lord, we pray for our missionaries around the world today, sharing your love in different countries with people. We want to be part of that too. We want to encourage them, we want to pray for them, but we also want to bless them monetarily for what they're doing, and we want to support them. Lord, I pray for the Lamers family today. Just be with them, support them during this difficult time in their lives. We just pray that you'll comfort them. Lord, we look forward to our sermon today about parenting from Pastor Austin. We want to be better parents. Those of us who are parents and we've come to know, it doesn't matter how old your kids are, you're always a parent. So, Lord, we want to hear what you have to say to us today. In Jesus' name, amen. Please stand up again and we'll continue to worship in song.
Comfort for every heart that mourns.
Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? No, no, in all of these things, we are more than conquerors with him who's loved us. For I am sure of this, that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Father, we hold to that truth. As we just sang it, we now hear it read, that Lord, no matter where we are, you cannot be separated from us. Lord, your love invades us. So Lord, whatever barrier that lies out before us, whatever uncertainty is in the path ahead, Lord, we know you are with us. Your sovereign hand that guides and directs every step of our journey. And so in that, when we are afraid, in that, when we are fearful, we can take courage because you're with us. Lord, may we then, this week, now attack the week knowing you're with us, God. What a powerful truth. The God of promises still keeping his promise. We believe that today. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Go ahead and be seated. Go ahead and be seated. Kids, you are dismissed this morning. Thank you, sir. All right, we're getting some good mornings. How about this? Say hi to someone. Just get up and say hi. We're getting good mornings going. A little, yeah, there, John's ready. Come on. We're a faith community. We love each other. Say hi. There we go, yeah. Waves will do. Waves from the back. There we go. Troyers, hello. All right, love that. Yeah, we're back. Meet and greet. Let's do it. Love that. Well, good morning. Good to see you here. My name is Austin, one of the pastors. Thank you for welcoming me back to fellowship with you. I've been gone on an extended break called a sabbatical, and my wife and I, we took some rest together, some things in our life. We had a tragic event happen. We had delivered a 14-week baby this summer. It was really hard for us, our second miscarriage, and so we're able to just spend some time, heal together. We feel way more refreshed, healed up a bit as we entered the fall. But as I was on sabbatical and, you know, grieving, but also healing with my wife, my kids, I was able to read a book as well called Burning in My Bones by Wynn Collier. And it was a biography of Eugene Peterson. And if you remember Eugene Peterson, he's the man that paraphrased the Bible and called The Message. And he got to be really popular, and so all these people were asking him to come and do speaking engagements, come be professors at his school, at these schools. And every time he thought he should go, he felt like he was always drawn back to the place he was pastoring. That he believed that the plot of earth that God gave him to tend, to shepherd, was in Maryland where his church was. And that really captivated my heart as I was going through my sabbatical. I came back and I was just fired up, excited about the plot of earth that God has given me to invest in and to shepherd, and that's in DuPage County. And so I was just excited to be back with you all at Crossroads. I know here at the Village Bible Campus, we're going through a transition, right? Where Pastor Craig's, he just called me this week. He's doing well down there at in Springfield. And so we're in a transitional period. But man, I came back so fired up because I believe the best is really yet to come for this location. I believe God's got some great things in store for us as we keep stepping out in faith, right? We talk about here as a mission statement of ours at Crossroads is helping everybody take their next step with Jesus. And so, yes, you take individual steps, but I believe this campus, this location right here, is going to take some giant steps of faith. And the best part of all, God never disappoints when we take faith steps, right? And he always fulfills the blessedness upon us. And so I believe that. I hope you're trusting that, believing that with us. It's going to be a lot of fun at the anniversary just sharing what God has done in the history of this church and also at the other location. So good for what's ahead. So I'm fired up. I'm rested. I hope I'm not shouting at you because I'm just excited to be with you all here this morning. I know you're excited about the Bible, and that's why you're here. So will you turn with me in your copy of the scriptures to Psalm chapter 78. Psalm chapter 78 is where we will turn this morning. If you don't have a Bible, you could go to your smartphone and get the app called the English Standard Version, ESV. That's what I'm going to be reading out of up here up front. One of the values of our church is that we believe that there's teaching that transforms. And you come here every Sunday to hear the message of Scripture. And what we're doing in this act, so we just, up here worshiping, hands raised, singing, praising God, what also is an act of worship is submitting ourselves under the Word of God. It's not my words, it's the Word of God speaking into your life today. And so as we go into the text, remember that this is the authority of God being pressed into your life. And so may you, maybe it's conviction, maybe it's encouragement, whatever you find in today's message, know it's the Word of God speaking into your life, because that's one of our values here at Crossroads. Well, you there, Psalm 78? Good? All right, we're in a, it's okay to talk back to me. I love the affirmation, the like, not that talk back, okay? I had a parent like, wait, that's not a good thing, talking back. No, actually, going off of parenting, today is a sermon titled Parenting and Kids. So all of you parents in the house, you're going to love this. And here's the thing. I'm also coming after you grandparents in the room. So there's some a message here for you out of Psalm 78 as well. But parenting is a great thing. The scriptures say that children are a blessing from the Lord. And that is the case. That is so true. But can we be honest that sometimes kids terrify us, okay? Because we're like, man, I didn't go to school, Anita, yeah, I didn't go to school to learn how to be a parent. And I remember when my wife and I were headed home from the hospital with our first. We were in the new parent parking at the hospital. The nurse escorted us out to check the car seat, make sure it was snug. It was all good and legit. She closed the door. We got into the car. We began to drive down the highway, excited. And we started talking, and we kind of got back into what it was like before kids. And then all of a sudden, we kind of forgot that we had a human in the back seat. And Wyatt, he made this little baby sound. And I still remember, like, driving, and my wife and I both, like, look at each other like, oh, we now have a child that we're taking home forever. Like, this wasn't a vacation at the hospital. Like, he's ours. Like, God gave us a human, and now it's our job to raise him. Like, wow, that's a big responsibility. And so wherever you're at in the flow of being a parent, whether you're in the infant stage, whether you're in the toddler, teenage, or maybe you have adult children, or maybe you're a grandparent and you got grandkids, this message is for you. Psalm 78 is the first parenting curriculum class, okay? And it's going to teach us what is the goals for parenting. The culture gives us a lot of goals for parenting. Be a great athlete. Gain a lot of money. Be famous on Instagram or TikTok, right? There's a lot of goals out there. But the question is, what type of goals would God want us to have as faithful followers of Jesus who are parents, right? And so what I want to do is I want to jump with you all to the goals in verse 7. And then we'll go back to the playbook. Like, how do we get to those, accomplish those goals? But I want us to shed light on what are the goals for parenting or being a grandparent. Verse 7. Verse 7 says this. So that they, that is the kids, and in verses 6, it's actually four generations of children. So that they, the four generations, should set their hope in God. Like goal, priority number one, that your kids would trust in the name of the living God. Like, you succeed. Victory lap for you as a parent if in their lifetime they come and kneel before the Master, the Lord God Almighty, and surrender their life to Him and hope in Jesus Christ. Like, that's the win for you. Second goal is they would not forget the works of God. They would remember the great deeds or wonders or what we're going to call today, and it's in the dictionary, the awesomeness of God. That they would have moments in their life where the awesomeness of God shines through, and they would never forget that. That's the second goal. Third goal from this parenting class from Asaph is this, verse 7, last sentence, but keep his commandments. Like that they would live a life of obedience to God's word. And all parents are like, obedience, yes, I can get on that train as a parent. So what are the goals again? Like if I'm going to be a successful parent, what goals am I striving for to accomplish? It's my kids would trust in Jesus, that they would remember his marvelous deeds in their life, and that they would live a life of obedience. It's like, okay, Austin, great. Sounds good. Those are the goals. Well, how do we get there? And get there is verse 1. Verse 1 is the playbook of the chapter. Verse 1 says this. This is Asaph. It's a wisdom psalm for us this morning. He says this under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Give ear, O my people, to my teaching. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth. I will open up my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings from of old, things that we have heard and known that our fathers have told us. Asaph starts by saying, come close to me, everybody. In the people of Israel, the kids to the adults, get close. I'm going to spend some intentional time telling you some stories, some important things you need to know so in your life you can be godly. We're not going to get to the entire chapter of 78. It's a long one. But what Asaph does through the entire time, so he just pulls everyone together and he spends the entire time telling God stories. He goes to say, you know, God, he delivered you guys from the hand of the Egyptians. Do you remember that? That's a wonderful deed God did in your life. Hey, do you remember when actual bread was falling from the sky and you were eating off the sandy floor of the desert? Like, yeah, God's really awesome. Do you remember the times when the enemies were encroaching all around you and God would deliver you out of their hand? Yeah, God's pretty awesome. What Asaph is going to drive towards, and here's the main point, this is the playbook, is that God's stories produce godly children. God's stories produce godly children. Those God stories are the stories you've seen in your own life. God doing remarkable things in your life. And the God stories are also this from the scriptures. 75% of the scriptures are in story format. The Noah's Ark story, Abraham, David and Goliath, all those are stories meant to captivate our hearts, to produce in us godly children, to be children of the living God. And so what I love here is Asaph is taking some intentional time. Question, parents, how are you doing being intentional about telling your kids God stories? Do you have a time in the week where you're intentionally telling them of what God has been doing? Is it around the dinner table? Is it right before bed? Do your kids know your faith story? Could your teenager, could your eighth grader tell me how mom or dad came to faith in Jesus? Have you impressed upon them like son, daughter, God saved me at Awana when I was this age, and he's done some remarkable things in my mom and dad. Hey, I've done this. God has took me at summer camp, and he's molded, and he grabbed a hold of my heart, and I surrendered my life to him and repented of my sin. And man, God's done remarkable things in my life. Can your kids tell you back, repeat your faith story? Have you been telling the intentional stories of God in your life? Asaph is going to tell us what to say in these moments, these intentional moments with our kids. Verse 4, he says, we will not hide them. That is these dark sayings. Dark sayings are simply these parables, things that are hard to understand. Like, we're not going to hide them. We're going to actually explain them to our kids. But tell to the coming generation. So this is a generational legacy we're talking about here. And here it is, folks, here it is. Here's what we're telling our kids. The glorious deeds of the Lord. His might and the wonders that he has done. Look, Austin, what's the playbook for me to accomplish that my kids trust in the Lord, they remember his works, and they live a life of obedience? Tell of the awesomeness of God and use it in stories he's given you personally and the stories from Scripture. He says the wonderful deeds, we'll just simply say the works of God. He says his might or his power in your life. And third is the wonders, or we'll say miracles that God has done. If you're taking notes, it's that. It's actively tell of God's works, his powers, his miracles in your life. We're going to call it God's just awesomeness. I got my son on the first opening night of NFL kickoff season. It was two teams playing, the Buccaneers and the Dallas Cowboys. And my older son, he felt really, you know, big because the brother was still sleeping and he got to stay up to watch the game with dad. So we're sitting there watching the game, and these commentators, they kept talking over and over about this one player on the Buccaneers. You probably have not heard his name, but the guy's name was Tom Brady, okay? And they just went on and on about this guy, Tom Brady. So my son, he's 5, he asks, you know, Dad, who is Tom Brady? And so what I began to do is tell of the awesomeness of Tom Brady. Like how many Super Bowls he's won. How he's 4 years old, still playing in the National Football League and looking better than ever. And I just began to tell of the awesomeness of Tom Brady. And later that night, I paused. And I thought, man, have I been telling him about the awesomeness of God as much as I've been telling him about Tom Brady? Have I painted such a beautiful picture of God's majesty in my life that my son's heart would be drawn to God and it would produce in him such a godly spirit that he would help but not set his hope in the Lord, that he'd remember God's marvelous works in our family, and that he would walk in obedience? Moms and dads, grandmas and grandpas, have we told the awesomeness of God? Have we intentionally sat them down and told them of the grandeur of God? When we're around the fire pit and we're looking up at the stars, can we tell them of how great of a God we serve? That's the call from Psalm 78. It's that you and I would tell the God stories, the works of God. The greatest work ever was the work of redemption, of salvation, how he saved us, how he put in motion. The entire book of the Bible is just simply one story. It's a narrative arc of the redemption of humanity. And have we told them enough of the gospel of Jesus? Right now, we stand on this floor, but underneath this floor, there are kids, some of your kids, underneath being taught God stories. Some of you may know this, some of you don't. The curriculum we teach the kids at Crossroads Community Church is the Gospel Project. And the Gospel Project simply is taking every story from Old Testament, New Testament, and it's pointing it to the gospel of Jesus Christ. How every story alludes, and it's a typology stretching out, focusing our attention on what God was doing in the person of Jesus. That's what we're doing downstairs right now as we're up here. Like, are you as well focused in on the intentional God stories? We're going to be celebrating our 20th anniversary on 10-10 at 10. Someone was brilliant. That wasn't my idea, but someone was smart to plan that out. But 10-10 at 10. And what we've been doing behind the scenes for this big event, and yes, I'm hoping for 1,000 people. It's going to be awesome. I love a lot of people. Some of you are like, I'm an introvert. I don't want to be there. Here's the thing. Bring your blanket, and you can be on like the lawn, like way out in the corner, okay? If you're like, too much people, is like, okay, that's for you. We got room for you. But we want you to be there. What we've been doing behind the scenes is just capturing the God stories of the last 20 years. And we're going to show you video of what God has done. And it's not about the buildings or another campus. It's not about the pastor or the worship team. It's really about what God has done in the life of actual individuals in our church. How he's redeemed them, transformed them. And we're going to tell those stories because we so easily forget. And we want the next generation and the generation to follow to know and sink deep into their spirit, their heart, the truth of the God stories. But can I be honest that it's hard to be intentional as a parent? I mean, if we're honest, some of us actually look back at our parenting and it's riddled with a lot of failures. And I would say, welcome to the club of no perfect parent allowed here. It just doesn't happen. It's not about perfection, but more about progress in our parenting. But some of you still are haunted by, man, I should have done this for my child, and I didn't. I was busy. I'm a working mom, and I came home, and I just didn't have the energy, and I should have taken that moment to teach my child something important, and I just didn't. I regret that. Some of you maybe even are deeper, as I didn't know Jesus when I had kids earlier on, and I didn't raise them how I would have if I was a believer. And so if I could walk into this tender moment with you of those failures that plague your mind and that cause passivity of, it's not going to get better. I've messed up too many times. I want to speak this over your life, that the gospel has the power to restore your parental failures. It has the power. I believe that with all of my heart. Because the gospel was not something you believed back then, but the gospel is something you banner over your life. Because here's what the devil wants to do, is the shame of those parental failures you've had in the past, he wants to cloud that over your head so you would stay passive instead of step in and say, no, I'm going to intentionally teach my kids the God stories because they are going to be godly children as I impress that in their life. Because if you're a believer here when Jesus Christ, the gospel speaks over your life, if you're in Christ, you are no longer condemned. So you throw off the shame of the horrible times that you haven't done always the right thing as a parent and say, no, I'm going to walk in freedom. I'm going to walk in purpose in the future because God speaks a different line over my life. He gives me a different script because of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Hear me, hear me. The gospel restores those parental failures because the gospel gives us the most powerful tool, and that is forgiveness. It allows you as a parent to forgive yourself when you've messed up. It allows for those kids when they become adults to forgive you and for you to forgive them when sometimes they don't always walk in obedience. That the gospel speaks into this issue of parenting. And so may you and I step into a new hope of parenting in the future and not go back into the cycle of passivity. God writes a different story because he gives us the gospel that restores brokenness in our homes. Well, Psalm 78 goes on, verse 5. He, that is God, established a testimony. Testimony is simply a story of God's goodness. He gave a testimony in Jacob. That's another way to say the people of Israel. And he appointed a law, meaning the Old Testament. Remember, Moses came down from the mountain and God gave them the word of God in Israel, which he commanded our fathers to teach. There's an action there, to teach, to impress upon them the testimony and the word of God to their children, that the next generation might know them and the children yet unborn, and arise and tell them to their children. That's four generations. Like, you want to talk about a legacy of faith, is that to the fourth generation, they're still telling the stories of great-great-grandfather and how God has redeemed him and the family. That's the legacy of faith. That's an A-plus, like, victory lap for you. And he does that through telling, teaching these stories, these testimonies, through teaching them the word of God. And so if you're writing anything down, you could do this. Intentionally download God's word into your kids' hearts. Intentionally download God's word into their hearts. I use the word download because we download stuff all the time, right? But there's really one thing you got to have in order to download, and that is what, Corey? What do you got to have in order to download something? You got to have internet. You got to be connected to the Wi-Fi. Like, you know, you school teachers, you like have a problem with the Wi-Fi, and you're like, I need help. IT, get here. And they're like, in 20 minutes, we'll show up. And you're like, what? I'm teaching in like 2 minutes. And it's like, I get this thing downloaded, this PowerPoint, whatever. And so download is all about being connected to in order to get the information. Here's where sometimes I think we can get amiss as parents. Is instead of parenting to connection and relationship, we parent to behavior modification. And it's oftentimes because it makes me look bad. Like, shape up, kid. Like, I don't want you looking bad for me at church. And it's like, I'm trying to just manufacture this kid to like look really good. And then we wonder why sometimes the kids in the church have these masks on, is because we've parented to behavior modification rather than to relationship. To spend the time and gear down and say, no, what is happening in the heart of my child? Instead of these little tweaks I'm trying to do on their behavior, am I stepping in to say, am I helping them download, here's what God wants for your life? God has a grander vision, right? Behavior modification is the little tweaks. The relationship is telling the God awesomeness. It's building in time to experience that and open up their heart to what God is doing. And so intentionally download God's word into their hearts. Ephesians 6:4 says, bring them up in the instruction and training of the Lord. And here, I love that he focuses in on grandparents. You grandparents in the room, you've got some work to do. You may be retired, but what Asaph is telling you is to go get that granddaughter and go get her fancy $8 drink at Starbucks and have a conversation about the God stories in your life. You should be able to have a numerous catalog of God doing some powerful things in your life. Maybe you saved someone from an illness in your family. They need to know that. When those moments where it's like, this can't be a coincidence, this was a God moment, those grandkids need to know that. My grandfather, his name is John David Adams. He's since been with the Lord. And when the grandkids get all together, we often share the stories of Grandpa. And two always rise out. And the first is funny. It's Grandpa in retirement. He had his big lazy boy, and he had the enormous phone that had the long cord. You know, like you could go to the living room or to the kitchen, and you had a limbo around it when he was on the phone, right? Like, he never got into cell phones. And what he would do there is he'd sit there and wait, and what would happen is telemarketers, salespeople would call my grandfather as he sat there, they'd open up and say, John David Adams, can we talk to you about this, that, or the other? And he said, yes, but I'll let you talk if you allow me to talk after. So he'd listen, and they'd do their spiel. At the end, he'd say, no, thank you. Now it's my turn. And what he would do is he'd spend the next minutes on the phone with this random salesperson, and he would intentionally tell them about the gospel of Jesus Christ. He would use every opportunity to tell them of the transformative work God has done in his heart. The other story we'd often tell is how Grandpa, he got this livestock trailer and he sweeped it out. And he didn't ask for permission. He just went and bought a bunch of Gospel of John's in Spanish. And he packed up this enormous livestock trailer. And he drove it down to Mexico. Like no backing of a ministry organization. He just went for it. And he just stood there with one other gentleman. And he just passed out these Gospel of John's to these people. And he would often pray around the dinner table that God would reach all of Mexico with the gospel of Jesus. Like these are the stories that now as a grandson, I want to pass on to my sons, to the fourth generation. And so much so that my oldest son, Wyatt, I gave him his grandfather, great-grandfather's name. So he's Wyatt John David Adams. So that when he asked me, Dad, why do I have two middle names? I can tell him of the God stories, of the family, the legacy of faith that he has, that he stands upon, to produce in him a godly heart. Grandparents in the room, you've got some work to do. Yes, you're in retirement, but seize those opportunities to speak of the God stories. And then Asaph, he tells us again the goals in verse 7. What are we working towards? Those moments where it's like the days are long, but the years are short. What are we working towards as parents is so that they would set their hope in God. Your child, as you have found in your life, the world, life itself, is going to come around and punch your kid in the stomach as hard as it can. And they're going to be on their hands and knees and be like calling you and saying, Mom, Dad, what is happening in my life? I got fired. I got this. Something happened in my life. And the win for you is that as they're on their hands and knees just being beat down by whatever the world throws at them, they say, but Mom, Dad, I don't know what's happened, but I trust and I'm hoping in God. I believe and I trust that he's working about good in this situation. Like, that's going to happen for them. And they're going to be out, and you won't be able to protect them as much as you want, and you won't be able to camouflage them from the world. That's going to happen. And so right now, as they may be young, preparing them to set their hope on God, to trust in him full on 100%. And that they would remember the works of God. Have you told them the grand awesomeness of God? May that stick in their heart as they tell their kids as well. And finally, they would obey, walk in obedience to God's word. Here's what I want to do. I want us to, as a faith community, join in a covenant again of parenting. To just recite. I just wrote it together this week of a reciting of a commitment as parents. And if you're a grandparent, you have to say this as well. But if you're a parent in the room, just everyone, I'm just going to ask you to stand right where you are. Go ahead and stand. And on the screen is this commitment for us as parents to re-engage in our mind what we're trying to accomplish. When we're frustrated, when we want to just veg out on Netflix, it's like, this is the thing I need to be striving towards. And so join me, and may this sink in as a commitment, as a covenant you're keeping with our Lord Heavenly Father. And let's do that together. We'll start with I commit. Here we go. I commit to telling my kids of the awesomeness of God. I will actively build a legacy of children who trust in God and his word. If I fail at times, I believe the gospel has the power to restore. With the power from your spirit, I will lead with strength in my calling as a parent. Father God, these parents, these grandparents in the room right now have just made another commitment to you. Lord, they've committed to walking with you so that they can tell the God stories, the moments that you've transformed their life, the moments from Scripture. And now, Lord, would you impress upon those children's hearts, Lord, the ones underneath our feet right now, that they would grow up to be godly men and women. Be warriors of the cross of Jesus Christ. And Lord, right now I pray for that child, that has abandoned the faith. Lord, maybe they've walked away. They're the prodigal son or daughter. And the parent here this morning is grieved at the waywardness of that child. Lord, I pray right now, it's 11:26, that right now there'd be a circumstance that would hit them, that would allow them to wake up from their sleeping and see you, the grandness of who you are, and they would turn their face to you. Would you not do that? Would you not pull them back in? God, for the parent here who's plagued by their own failures, may they speak over their life the gospel that restores and not believe in the lies that would want them to make them passive or withdraw. Lord, thank you for giving us your word, your handbook on how to set up our kids to be godly, that they would trust in you, remember your grand works, and they would walk in obedience. May that be the case, we pray. In your name, amen.
We're going to close with this song, confessing our need for the Lord. I fall apart. Lord God, we do proclaim our need for you this morning. We ask that as we go from this place, God, we would continue to lean on you as parents, as children, and just as people, as children of the Heavenly Father. So we ask this as we go. In your name, amen. Have a great week.